nature was quiet for a while, thinking and dying. Then he said, I've been here since I was 20 years old. See, my other brother Curtis, he was a Black Panther. I looked up to him. I wanted to be just like him. So much so, when he got locked up for protesting and carrying on, I decided I would try to be a Panther too. It's my older brother, you know, he was a Black Panther, so I wanted to be a Panther too. Just like him, because he was so cool. So much so that when he got locked up for protesting and carrying on, I decided I would try to be a Panther too. Me and some of the fellas, you know, we went out to Oakland and decided to keep the mission of peace going. So we decided to share it across the whole nation. We were making our way across the country, and we stopped off in Detroit. In Detroit. Detroit was real cool. We stopped off. And Detroit had their own Panthers, too.
His baton. right here.
But what he didn't realize was that when he did that, I lost 20% of my hearing. I couldn't hear it no more. He hit me in my head, or up to my eardrum. I lost my hearing. I used to love music. Because remember, the Black Panthers, we were cool. Missing the funk. We used to have those parties. These pretty ladies out there, summertime. Mind our own business. We just wanted to be cool. Take care of our communities. We didn't hurt nobody. It was all cool. And I could hear that music. But you know what? Today I lost 20% of my hearing. I can't hear anymore because he hit me for no reason.
Huh? What?
That rookie put the wrong person that day. With one blow, I knocked him out cold. With one blow, I knocked him out cold. Not two, not three. One blow upside his big old head, and I knocked him out cold. The problem was, though, he hit his head on the sidewalk, and then he ended up going in a coma, and then he died 2 months later. Oh shit, my ass was crashed, and I knew it. There I was, the Black Panther that I had killed a white cop, and they had all those reports about my black ass. The truth was, I wasn't even nothing like that. I wasn't even a Panther for real. I just wanted to be. I had never even been in a real fight my whole life. But then when you hit me with the baton, I just kind of lost it. I'm really a peaceful guy. I mean, I was standing there with the Black Panther sister. I just wanted to be cool. It was cool. And I lost my brother, you know, when he moved to town, I just went somewhere crazy. And I thought about my brother who's got locked up, and I just wanted to be like him. And they all got misunderstood, you know? We all just got misunderstood. We was trying to do the right thing. We wanted peace. We wanted something good. All that energy was behind the punch I gave him. And that's why I laid him out. That's why I laid him out. According to the judge, I was a dangerous criminal who needed to be made an example of. They made an example of me all right in order to get the message around to all those other Panthers, anyone who's associated with him. He threw the book at me. I said, and even though what happened wasn't even my fault, I'm paying for it with my life. I'm paying for it. Kissing for the last time, and with her wall of bravery began to crumble, family members gathered around her tenderly and escorted her to her seat. It was now my turn to go up. And say my final goodbye with an uncertain step forward. I peered inside, expecting to see my father, but that person laying in front of me was stiff with gray leather skin. His face was heavily made up, wispy, his hair parted and slipped to one side. My father would never wear his hair like that. My daddy might look different, my mother said, but looks wasn't all that was different. At 6 feet tall, my dad was larger and stronger than life. That's my dad. Larger and stronger than life, but that stronger thing in the cast is frail and withered from unsuccessful rounds of chemotherapy. It wouldn't seem to as to me anymore. It's the handle of an airbrush with me, or a smooth away the wrinkles of schoolyard hard stuff with a silky voice. This thing couldn't do that. This thing couldn't do that. Because this thing wasn't even him. It couldn't be him. I pushed with anger over spending my final moments with this imposter. Look how this is. Some leather, gray leather thing up in the castle. That ain't my daddy. Was. The right cheek of that being wore a painfully accurate scar that my father earned when our bike race ended with a fist packed in the gravel lot. One of the pebbles of the star stayed sharp right there on his working cadence. In spite of that red cheek, that thing was my dad. That thing was my dad. That thing in the casket. That thing, that leathery gray thing with the scar, that really was my dad. Yeah. I waited for his voice to sound in my ears, telling me that I was the precious one that he loved, that he loved me. But that cool shell couldn't do that. That little shell couldn't do that. It couldn't give me what I wanted. He just laid there, stiff, unmoving, his permanently pursed lips. Through the finality, my open eyes closed, too fatigued to stay open. But then, why'd you have to leave, Daddy? Why'd you have to leave? I asked him. He didn't answer. I asked him. He didn't answer. Daddy, why'd you have to leave? I asked him. He didn't answer. That thing is. This is my last moment. I asked him why he had to leave, and that thing is just laying there all withered and gray and leathery looking. It's not my dad. And then my mother's loving arms came. They love me. The tears started coming faster. She couldn't brush them away. I had the wisdom of always knowing what to do. She rocked me back and forth, soothing the pain that she could never really heal because I will always watch over you. What? I will always watch over you. Who said that? I will always watch over you. I'll never leave your side. My father, he whispered in my ear. He will always watch over me. He would never leave my side. Did you guys see that? No, none of you saw that because you don't know him. You're looking at this great name. You don't know my daddy like I know my daddy. He just told me he would never leave my side. Daddy? My eyes squeezed tight. I was not able to see an image. This vision of him, it was three-dimensional. It was real. It was my dad. He was standing there, and he was standing right next to me. He said, I would never leave your side. He was glowing, radiant, full of life. I would never leave your side. As only who could, my father had defied the laws of death because he was my daddy. That in my universe, he was always alive, and my daddy will always be alive.
Yeah.
He will always be alive. Because he would never leave. My daddy will always be alive. Because he never would leave me. He never did. Miss Monica Rochelle from Detroit. She has a series of books called the Bell Isle Heights series. And she worked a Fortune 500 job making lots of money, and she decided to follow her own dreams, and she quit that job and started writing books for a living. Now she's on her fifth book. She's the CEO of her own company, and it's my little sister, and I'm real proud of her.